Shabbat Shalom. I hope everyone is doing well and ready for a restful and healing Shabbat. I want to talk for a few moments about a big issue, a big question, and that is, how do we know that what we're doing matters? How do we know we're making a difference? And this is a question that can be applied to so much in life. It can be applied to precautions we're taking for a pandemic, to avoid illness and loss, and how do we know that what we're doing makes a difference? It can be applied to everything in life, to spirituality. How do we know that this prayer makes a difference, that this study session makes a difference, that this service makes a difference? How do we know, and how do we measure success? I want to address this by offering an insight that comes from our Torah portion this week. We read a double portion this week of Chukat and Balak. And the story of Balak, we read of Balak, who was this evil king, who was kind of set on causing destruction or hurting the Jews, and so he engages this prophet of Bilam. But this is Balak's initiative, and in the course of trying to harm the Jews, he actually offers up any number of sacrifices to God in his prayers that these sacrifices will be heard by God and thereby be of detriment to the Jewish people. And the Talmud says something remarkable. It says that someone should always engage themselves in Torah and mitzvot. You should always do good things, even if they're not for the right reason. Even if doing them one doesn't have the holiest of aspirations, and even negative aspirations. It says, do the act, and it's going to have an impact. And the way we know that is the proof is from Balak, is from this king, because he offered all these sacrifices, and how do we know that he was rewarded? Because Ruth was his descendant. In the story of Ruth, Ruth's grandfather was Eglon. Eglon's grandfather was Balak. We see Ruth as a direct descendant of King Balak. And as the Talmud teaches, that Ruth and the existence of Ruth and the merit of Ruth was a result of the good acts that Balak performed, even though his intentions weren't great. In the 19th century, Rabbi Naftali Tzvi Yehuda Berlin, the Netziv, he offered this insight, or he quoted this Talmud as a way of proving that impact can sometimes take generations. And he said, you know, Balak did something wrong, and he merited having a reward, but the reward didn't happen for many, many years, for many, many generations. And when the Netziv was asked whether there's merit in establishing all of these programs of Jewish study, of Jewish identity to combat secularism, he said, absolutely there's merit. We have to do the right thing. And even if you don't see the results right away, they may come in a generation, in two generations, in three generations. You just never know when the impact will be felt, when it'll land in a productive way. You know, a number of years ago, I attended a conference actually in Winnipeg. It was an interfaith conference, all the world religions, and they made special kosher provisions for myself and for a few others who were there, that we would have kosher food to eat at this conference. And I remember one day, I was in the kitchen. I was walking around the kitchen, checking on the food and talking to some of the staff there. And I was talking to one of the people who worked for the caterer. And she said to me, she said, you know, just kind of out of the blue, she said, you know, I have a daughter. I said, that wonderful. What, tell me about her. How old is she? Said, oh, she's 3 years old at the time. And she said, but you'll never guess her name. I said, okay, your daughter's name. Now tell me, how would I be able to guess? And she said, my daughter's name is Chaya. And I was a little bit taken aback. I said, oh, I didn't know that you were Jewish. That's a very Jewish name. And she said, I'm not Jewish. I said, so how did a non-Jewish woman in Winnipeg end up naming her daughter Chaya? And she said, well, you know, years ago when my husband and I were on our honeymoon, we were traveling in Thailand, and we met this Israeli man, and we really connected with him. And he told us about his sister Chaya, who had been killed in a terror attack in Israel. And we were so impacted by his story that we decided to perpetuate his sister's memory through our daughter. And that's why there's one little girl out there in Canada named Chaya, who has this incredible story behind her name. And I think of the story as just this great model of continuity and of perpetuating a message that sometimes we don't know the impact of one conversation, of one relationship, of one moment of inspiration, but a conversation, a connection that happened on a honeymoon years ago ended up having an impact that allowed one's memory to be perpetuated years later. And I think this is a great model, a great lesson in life, that we never know the impact that we're going to have on others. And just like Balak had to wait many, many generations to see, we know the one thing we're guaranteed is that when we do good, it will have a positive impact. We may not always see the direct results, but that should never discourage us from doing the good action and from receiving that reward whenever it comes, whether it's in this lifetime or whether it's many, many generations to come, to know that we are guaranteed that every good act is paid its just reward. Hope everyone has a wonderful Shabbat, and be well and stay healthy.
Shabbat Shalom. Hope this finds you and your loved ones well, as I'm trying to enjoy another Shabbat afternoon song with you. Actually, this one, Yedid Nefesh, has a tradition to be sung both before Kabbalat Shabbat on Friday evening and at Seudah Shlishit on Shabbat afternoon. This is also a song that has many different attributions to many different famous medieval Jewish poets, but the time of origin, that being the Middle Ages, is certainly not in question. The other things that are in question about this song are some of the textual aspects. In certain cases, in certain publications, you'll see the words in Zachar, the masculine, and in others, Nekeva, the feminine. So I've chosen to sing it this week from the text that the Koran Birkon uses, and you'll find it a little bit different maybe from what you know, but it doesn't lose the beauty either of the imagery in the text or of the melody. Yedid nefesh av harachaman mishochav dach el retzonach yarutz av dach kemo hayal yishtachaveh mul hadarach ki yerov lo yedidutach minofet tzuf vechol tam hadur nae ziv haolam nafshi cholat avatach ana el narifana na beharot la nom zivach az titchazek vetitrape vehayetalach shifchat olam vatik yemu rachamecha v'chusna al ben ohavach ki zekama nichsof nichsaf lirot betiferet uzach ana eli machmad libi chushana ve'al ti Yitanam Higadena Ufros Chaviv Adai Etzukat Sheromach Ta'ir Eret Mikvodach Nagira Venismechabach Maher Yahuv Kiva Moed Vechoneni Kibmei Olam Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 Yai dai 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 dai
Shabbat Shalom.